Hi, everybody. Wonderful to see this number of people at 8:30 on a Monday morning. So I was wondering if I was going to be talking to 5, 10, or some larger number, and this is good news. So my talk today is entitled Assessing Vendor AI Claims Like a Data Scientist, Even If You Aren't One. So the talk's really about what it says on the tin here. Hope you come away from this with some insight as to how to grill a security vendor around the quality of their machine learning models. So grilling security vendors about their machine learning models is part of my job. I'm chief scientist at Sophos. We're a fairly large cybersecurity company. We protect about 500,000 organizations from cyber attacks and about 100 million endpoints from cyber attacks. One of my job functions, I evaluate small startups that we're thinking about acquiring and evaluate their machine learning programs. So much of this talk is going to come out of that experience of trying to really get under the hood with respect to how vendors are creating machine learning systems that go into securing networks and assessing how good those systems are. The other, just by way of introduction, the other thing I should say is I run a machine learning program at Sophos. My team's about 34 people, I think, right now. And the function of my team is to research, develop, integrate, and operationalize machine learning technologies within lots of different security products. So we've produced machine learning models that detect phishing emails in our email security product, detect malware in our Android and Windows security products, detect malicious web content and files in our firewall. So I've got a background in doing this kind of work. So what I'm going to talk about today is sort of based on that experience. There'll be time for questions at the end, but if there are points of clarification, things that aren't making sense, if I'm not speaking in a clear way, just raise your hand and ask. I think that would be great. I think it would probably be helpful to other people here too. Okay, so I'm going to use this clicker. Okay, disclaimer. So the structure of this presentation, I'm going to start by talking about why I think we need this talk in our industry now. Then I'm going to get into some machine learning basics just to make sure we're all on the same page about the basic ideas behind machine learning. Then I'm going to go from sort of theory to practice and talk about all the ways in which doing security AI in the real world is just way different than what you learn in the textbooks, all the messy realities of our discipline. And then finally, and this is going to be the largest section of the talk, I'm going to talk about how you should interrogate a security vendor or a security machine learning team to really assess the efficacy of what they're doing. And then I'll end with some next steps. Okay. Why do we need this talk? I want to start with this kind of binary. I would say the following two statements are true. Machine learning has become an absolutely critical technology within almost every tech product that exists today. Anywhere where you need to make inferences about complex data, machine learning is probably applicable. That definitely includes security, right? A big part of security is really focused on looking at data and identifying signs of suspiciousness, signs of breach, that kind of thing. And like machine learning is an obvious tool for that job. So I think that's true. But I think what's also true is that the way machine learning gets talked about in our industry right now is really dysfunctional. So vendors just throw out terms like next generation artificial intelligence. They try to differentiate in ways that obfuscate and are unprincipled. And there's just very little signal. Like if you go walk the trade floor at this company, I haven't done that yet. I think it opens tomorrow, actually. But you know, you'll definitely see all sorts of signaling around AI that is not super productive in terms of our ability to assess what's really going on. I would say on the one hand, we need AI. On the other hand, the way we're operating within our industry around AI is not conducive to the kind of progress that we really need to better protect people. That's the motivation for this talk. You know, this talk is just, you know, one, it's a small contribution towards the problem of like changing our culture around the way we talk about machine learning. We need to get to sort of clear descriptions of what people are actually doing and clear descriptions of the efficacy and blind spots and inevitable weaknesses of any given technology. Okay, All right, so I'm gonna start by so for those folks here who are like data scientists, you know, this part you may want to just sort of zone out on. But I'm gonna start by sort of honing in on the way that machine learning works to get sort of a common baseline here. Okay, so the vast majority of machine learning that's actually used in a useful way in security today is supervised machine learning, and that's what I'm gonna describe right now. So if you look at this diagram. All of the basic ideas behind the way that machine learning operates in security products today are represented in this diagram. So if you're gonna build a security machine learning model, like say a malware detector, the steps that you follow are you get a data set of executables. So let's say you're trying to detect malicious like .exe files, like your .exe, .dll, .sys, you know, Windows PE files. You get a large data set of known malware and known benignware, and you create a numerical representation of each item in that data set. So in this example, the text is a little small, apologies if you can't see it, but I've mapped the data to a three-dimensional space where each executable is represented in terms of how compressed the executable is, the number of human-readable character strings that exist in the executable, and the size of the executable. So once I've represented the data numerically in this way, I can plot it, right? So I've plotted it in this three-dimensional space here. And you can see there's a pattern, right? So, I mean, this is not real data, and this is a hypothetical example, and the pattern is far too simple. But basically, you know, in this hypothetical example, the malware tends to be on the sort of bottom left of the plot, and the benignware tends to be on the upper right of the plot. You can see that there's a clear setup here, right, in which we can identify a plane that generally separates the malware from the benignware. So the big idea behind machine learning really is we want to identify a boundary between our two classes, a boundary between the malicious stuff and the benign stuff. And all the math, most of the math in machine learning is around defining a mathematical function that gives us that boundary. But that's the basic setup, right? We want to find a decision boundary between our examples, our suspicious examples, and our benign examples. So whether you're using, I'll go back for a second, like whether you're using a neural network or a set of decision trees or a Bayesian classifier, it all reduces to identifying this decision boundary in a decision space, in a feature space. Okay, now, so typically we don't just use three features, right? I use three features here because it allows us to plot our data in a way where we can actually visually identify patterns. In the real world, data scientists are operating in a much higher dimensional world. So for example, every pixel in an image could get a dimension, and then you're operating in this like million dimensional space. Or every field in an executable's file headers could get its own dimension. Every word in a language could get a dimension. So typically we're operating in a space that we can't visualize, but still we always have this idea of a space in which we're operating, and the machine learning model is identifying a boundary in that space between good and bad. And from that, these simple ideas, right, we can get really robust pattern matchers. So here's an example of a kind of neural network called a convolutional neural network identifying objects in a clip from James Bond. And really, you know, when it's identifying people, the bulk of what's going on can really be described in the way that I just described machine learning, which is it's identifying a kind of decision boundary in the space of pixels. And so you can get, I mean, the basic ideas behind machine learning are pretty simple, but you can build pretty sophisticated systems by scaling up the machine learning model, scaling up your training data, and doing a bunch of clever tricks that people have identified over the last, you know, five decades or so. Okay, so those are the basics. Now I want to talk about what machine learning looks like in the real world. And I want to start by identifying what I think are a bunch of myths. These are intentionally provocative, and some people may argue with them, but I think they're basically true. So there's one myth, and I think you confront this a lot when security vendors are pitching their products. And this is the myth that like mathematical sophistication is what drives accuracy in machine learning, and it's just really not true. I mean, you need to understand the math, I think, to build good machine learning models. But The best systems that I've seen for detecting malicious domains, malware, malicious apps, malicious web pages, use published ideas that you can find on Wikipedia, but they just execute really well on those ideas. They use good training data. They use good feature representations. It's really not the math that's the prime lever in driving accuracy in today's machine learning systems. And that's not what you always get from the way that machine learning gets discussed in our industry. Second, the idea that the learning algorithm is used, which learning algorithm is used is what drives accuracy. So to some extent, you know, you'll get, sometimes people will argue that, well, they're using like a transformer neural network or a convolutional neural network, or they're using, you know, gradient boosted decision trees, this kind of thing, and that's the key differentiator in their product. It's not what I've found to be the case. Usually in our experience on the team that I manage, and also what I've seen out among other sort of fraternal and you know, teams that we're connected to and at other companies, you know, there for a given problem, there are a few different approaches that work almost exactly as well as one another. So usually it's not like the one algorithm that's driving accuracy. And third, if somebody says they've got some original mathematical idea that goes beyond what's public knowledge, that's never been published, that's secrets, that it's a trade secret, and we can't actually find out about how the math works, that's usually a red flag, I would say. It's a little bit like somebody arguing they've got a new cryptography algorithm. Like, I'd much rather use a cryptography approach that has been peer-reviewed and has been around for a while and proven versus bespoke. You know, I think you really never should use bespoke cryptography that's not published and is a trade secret. I think it's a similar, if a vendor is not willing to be open about the kind of approach they're using, and it's not a fairly well-known and tested approach, I would treat that as suspicious. And then finally, you know, I've seen vendors claim that their machine learning supersedes signatures, allow lists, and block lists, which are sort of the staple tools of detection within the security industry. And I've just never actually seen an effective deployment of a machine learning system where the machine learning system wasn't coupled with signatures, allow lists, and block lists. You actually have to have all of those technologies in order to build an effective system. I'll talk a little bit more about that later. Okay, so here are the things that I think actually matter, and things that I've observed in my experience actually matter in terms of achieving a really good accuracy and efficacy with security machine learning systems. So first and foremost, timely real-world data and large data volumes. So I think this should be obvious, but it doesn't get talked about enough. If you're gonna train, let's say, a phishing web page detector on data from 2017 deploy it in 2022, that's a big problem, right? Because phishing web pages have just changed, and machine learning isn't magic. It doesn't have the ability to extrapolate to the trends in cyber attacks 5 years later, right? You know, I've seen companies and teams build models on some static research data set they got from some academic context a few years ago, and they don't have a means to retrain the system on new data because they're just using this experimental data set that they got from a research agency or something like that. I mean, that's just not a recipe for success. Regardless of the math, the system design, how the system's integrated, that's just a showstopper. You need timely real-world data. And that's just a key thing to ask about if you're evaluating a security machine learning team. You want to know where they're getting their data and at what volume, and you want to know that it's continually refreshed with new data that tracks the changing threat landscape. Okay, second thing, correct data labels are absolutely critical. Data labels are basically, you know, so if you get, let's say, for the executable use case, if you get like a big data set of .exe files. The labels are the information about whether they're good or bad. And data labels are a huge problem in security because we live, you know, we're working in a world in which the labels, the adversaries are trying to confuse our labels constantly. Like, you're not gonna get, like, so at Sophos, we train our Windows malware detector on hundreds of millions of .exe files. And we know that some of the files that we are training on as good are actually bad. They're malware that we just missed, and so we know that our system is We know that there's some noise in our training data that's confusing our system, and we work really, really, really hard to reduce that noise to the bare minimum. But everybody deals with this problem, right? And this is a key question to ask a security vendor. You know, how do you deal with label noise? How do you know there aren't false negatives in your labels? How do you know that there aren't examples that you're training on as benign that are actually malicious? Effort expended in addressing this problem, which can never be addressed perfectly but needs to be addressed, really, really pays off in my experience in driving system accuracy. Okay, third point. An evaluation that accurately estimates how well your system will work in the wild is just absolutely critical to machine learning security research and development. So, like, an evaluation is like, let's say somebody on a security machine learning team develops a prototype and they're like, you know, this prototype works really well, we should deploy it. The next question is, how do you know, right? And the evaluation is all about how you know. And so, like, on a data science team, your evaluation is really the compass that guides your whole team. And if it's bad, right, that compass is going to point you in the wrong direction, and you're going to think that you've developed a good system and it's not actually good. And if it's good, then you're headed in the right direction. So oftentimes, like, I'll see vendors claim that they, you know, achieve some given accuracy statistics, like, you know, 90% precision, 80% recall, whatever, something like that. And the real question is, how did you arrive at that in the foggy, uncertain world of cybersecurity, where we don't actually know for sure what's good and what's bad? And that's why you need to drill in on how an organization is conducting that evaluation. And then finally, you always want to deploy a machine learning system, like I've never seen a case where you don't, in conjunction with heuristics, with lookups that define known good and known bad. Those are what I'm calling allow lists and block lists here. If a vendor doesn't have a coherent strategy for doing that, isn't combining their machine learning with heuristics, like, so for example, we deploy, so on the Windows malware detector examples, so like we deploy our Windows malware detector at Sophos to tens of millions of endpoints, but it's combined with heuristics, like for example, even if the malware detector thinks that a Microsoft signed binary is malicious, we don't block it from executing, right? Like, we need that heuristic in there, because otherwise we run the risk of bricking millions of machines, you know? Like, you want to know what kind of heuristics a vendor is rolling into their overall detection pipeline along with their machine learning system. If they don't have a coherent strategy around that, that's a problem. I want to talk a little bit about the role of signatures, allow lists, and block lists when they're deployed in conjunction with machine learning, because I think it's so critical to any deployment of a security machine learning system. Basically, if we go back to our visual picture of what a machine learning detector does in a security context, you can see that plane, which is the machine learning model, it does a great job at identifying the general pattern of where malware and benignware land in our three-dimensional feature space here, right? But it doesn't do a great job at handling the outliers. So for example, you can see on the lower left where I have the arrow that says signature allow list, there's a benign example, right? So if it falls on the wrong side of the decision boundary. You want to use either a lookup or a heuristic, also known as a signature, to suppress that error, right? And then you see the same thing on the other side, right, where you see, you know, a piece of malware that's, you know, we would false positive on if we were just to use the machine learning model. And you know, you want to use a block list or a signature to suppress that. I think this diagram really gets it at a useful conception of the separation of concerns between machine learning, signatures, allow lists, and block lists. Like, you really want to use them. I think in the design of a security detection system, I think it's appropriate to use machine learning to identify the broad patterns in your data of what defines suspicious. And then you want to use signatures, allow lists, and block lists tactically in order to deal with examples that you're missing. I should also say, operationally, machine learning signatures, allow lists, and block lists have a very different profile. So, like at Sophos, we retrain our machine learning models quarterly and ship them out to all of our firewalls, endpoints, and other sort of machine learning consumers. But we deploy signatures daily, depending on the tactical picture. Like, if there's some new threat that's emerged, then we deploy a new signature. And allow lists and block lists get updated multiple times a day. So they're just different, and that's part of the reason I think you need both. Okay, so last section of the talk, how to politely interrogate a security machine learning team. So here, the setup I'm imagining is sort of like the way you interview a job candidate, right? Like what sorts of questions do you ask to really get at the efficacy of what this team is doing? And you know, I'm mostly imagining like interrogating a security vendor that's claiming to have a really good machine learning sort of component of their product. Okay, so here's my attempt at creating a model of like what the life of a security data science team looks like. There are four categories of work that a security data science team is engaged in at any given point in time. So one, and they're all just like critical, I'd say. So one is, but most of them don't get talked about. So on the left is data engineering. So this is like huge. I'll just reference my team since it's what I know best. Like on our team, we spend, in the millions of dollars on cloud infrastructure to support loading data into our infrastructure, to support loading telemetry back from our products that allows us to evaluate how our machine learning is doing in the field. All of that work is really, really hard, right? We're fusing data from sandboxes, from endpoint behavioral traces, from web browsers, from threat feeds that we pay other vendors for. And all that data is getting normalized and fused, and we have a whole team that just works on not machine learning, but just that, like data quality issues, making sure data feeds are up and running, backfilling data when data feed daemons go down, that kind of thing. And that's really the foundation of all the data science work that we do. Because if our data has errors in it, if a daemon went down that's loading a threat feed of URLs, and or if there's a bug in it, and so bad URLs are getting labeled as good URLs, and good URLs are getting labeled as bad URLs, that's all going to pollute the machine learning downstream. And that stuff happens. You get bugs all the time in that kind of pipeline. And so aside from all the math and the more sort of flashy bits of machine learning, I mean, this is an absolutely critical piece. Research obviously gets talked about the most, right? It's the most glamorous part of all this, I would say, although maybe it shouldn't be. But that's where you're designing neural networks, designing the sort of mathematical approaches that you're using to detect attacks. The integration piece is absolutely essential. That's where you integrate the machine learning system into a product. And it's where you integrate it into like the stuff I've been talking about, like allow lists, block lists, signatures, that kind of thing. That matters a huge amount also. You may have a great machine learning system, but let's take the case of executables again, but you're only using it, in a special case where a file's been downloaded from the web, right? This happens all the time with machine learning models. Like maybe you're only targeting a certain type of files with it. But if you don't ask those questions about like which data you're pointing the machine learning system at, so you're not getting the full picture about how the whole product actually works and how the machine learning system is being leveraged. There's just lots of questions you can ask about it, how a given team is approaching integrating a machine learning system into a larger product. And then finally, operations are absolutely critical. I mean, machine learning should be a closed loop system in which you deploy a machine learning model into the fields, you get feedback from the machine learning model's predictions, you do a running evaluation around the errors the model is making, and then what you learn is fed back into the next iteration of the model where you retrain the model and ship it. You should be monitoring for, is the accuracy collapsing? If so, your team should be set up to rapidly retrain and redeploy that model. All those questions are absolutely critical. A great setup in terms of data engineering, research, and integration will just fall apart if you don't retrain your model for 18 months, right? It'll fall apart if you can't actually track the accuracy of your model in the fields and sense when things are going wrong to actually address them. Okay, so normally, I would say, in the way machine learning gets talked about in the marketing, folks mostly stop at the level of depth of talking about what are the inputs to the machine learning model and what's like the fancy deep learning math that goes into the model. Really, you have to evaluate this whole picture to get any sense of the efficacy of a given machine learning product. You really have to. And when I do evaluations of companies that are claiming to have security AI technology, I get to the math part last. I really start on the left with data engineering. At a high level, I talk about the research, but I mostly ask about the valuation my main question is, how do you know this model is good, right? And that opens up a whole bunch of questions around, sure, you did well on this, like, academic challenge, but how do you know you'll do well when you deploy this, you know, to computers that are seeing data that you didn't see in training, right? How do you know that you're going to do well in the future versus on data that you because that's really, you know, where the rubber meets the road, right? How do you know you're going to do well 6 months from now when an attack hits my network? I really talk about the math as, it's a minor part of the evaluation. Then you know, talking about the integration, the operations, essential for the reasons that I already said. So here are like some example questions that I always ask teams. So on the data engineering front, where did you get your training data from? Why do you think it's representative of the data that I'll see on my network? A phishing email classifier trained mainly on English emails is clearly not going to work very well on emails written in Hungarian, right? These are basic questions that one should ask, and you often can identify real gaps in the technology just by asking, where's your training data from, and how representative is it of data that we're going to see in the context that actually matters? How do you know what good and bad look like in your training data and evaluation data? So, you know, it's great if you have a representative set of emails from all over the world, but if half of the malicious emails are actually labeled as benign because you don't know that they they're malicious, that's really going to pollute your classifier. So you really want to know that the vendor has a process for correctly labeling their data. And it's never going to be perfect, right? But you want to hear, for example, that they've got a team of human analysts who are engaged in continuous exploration of the data to find new threats and who are correcting labels on a continuous basis as they identify errors. That's that sort of thing. You don't want to hear that people just trust that the labels are right, because that doesn't make sense in a cybersecurity setting. And then finally, how do you fuse data from multiple sources to yield the best training and evaluation data? So for example, let's say you're training a system to detect malicious endpoint behavior. Typically, what people do in that space is they use data from sandboxes, like VirusTotal Sandbox or CuckooBox Sandbox, as training data. But then they're also using endpoint examples of breach at the same time. That data has to be normalized. There are complex engineering questions as to how you fuse those two data sources together, and you really want to know that your vendor is sophisticated about how they do that. Okay, just doing a time check here. So on the research front, I always bias towards, let me put it this way. I think that if a security vendor is describing their mathematical approach to you and using a lot of fancy buzzwords, you really want to bring the discussion back to a grounding and where can I find this in a textbook? Where can I find this on Wikipedia? And how is this grounded in what the machine learning community as a whole has achieved over the last half century of research? Again, if they're claiming to have developed something completely new, the burden of proof is very high that's better than the sort of textbook approaches which basically work well, I would say. I mean, not that there isn't room for creativity, but in security machine learning, but I think you have to really, really know the rules in order to break them. And I always check for a groundedness in the sort of established set of approaches. Again, what was the evaluation process? And then I always ask, when they're claiming inaccuracy, I want to see the complete evaluation process by which they arrived at saying that they achieved 90% accuracy or whatever it is. You can claim whatever number, but you really want to dig into how they arrived at that number, and you want to get some sense of how their claimed accuracy of 90% actually will map onto your network setting. Along the lines of some of the things I said before about how the data set maps and that kind of thing. On the integration front, how do you combine your system with allowless, blockless, and signatures? How do you close the loop in your system? So once your system's out there, what's your process for monitoring the system, updating it, dealing with accuracy collapses when some new wave of attacks come out that cause problems, or some set of software updates come out from sort of the world of benign IT that cause lots of false positives? How do you adapt to that? It's important also. How do you monitor the accuracy of your system of deployment? How do you deal with crises, like I just said? How often do you retrain and redeploy all those operational questions I talked about before as well. Okay, so takeaways. So hopefully I've given you a picture of security machine learning practice as not mainly about math, right? About a kind of gestalt engineering picture in which one has to think in a sophisticated way about data, data pipelines, data databases, data normalization, data fusion, labeling, manually looking through your data to identify problems and identify malware that you may have missed, practical thinking about how machine learning systems get integrated into the larger ecosystem of tried and true security detection technologies like signatures, block lists, and allow lists, operational sophistication around how once you've deployed a machine learning model, you monitor it, sense problems, address those problems as fast as possible, rigor around retraining and redeployment of the model on a regular basis, designing a good evaluation so you actually know a system will work when you deploy it. Hopefully I've given you a picture of security machine learning as really an ecosystem in which lots of things have to come together, including the math, but lots more. So I'd say, you know, next time you talk to a security vendor or as you walk the trade floor, right, keep these things in mind. Hope this has been helpful. I'd say, you know, immediate actions you can take, like hopefully use some of the concepts that you got here in having discussions about security AI technology. For those of you who are data scientists in the audience, hopefully you got something out of this also. My friend Hillary Sanders and I wrote a book about security data science called Malware Data Science. It's about 4 years dated at this point, but I think it's still highly relevant from No Starch Press, so I'll plug the book here. I'll stop there. I think I went faster than I thought I would, so there's definitely time for discussion and questions. So thanks, everybody. Yeah, please. Yeah. I think I can, okay. Yes, please.
I like to say usually that machine learning versus signatures, the output is the question, not the answer. How would you look at that? Is that something that you feel also, or if you're saying machine learning will also give you answers once it's run?
Yeah. So the question was, the colleague said, one way of thinking about machine learning signatures is that, so tell me if I have this right. So machine learning outputs a question, like is this possibly a breach, like for example, whereas a signature outputs an answer, like, okay, this is bad. Like, yeah, like
a...
Yeah. Yeah.
If you write like a rule that says access to 7,000 and fail login is something, then you have the answer. So, so would you say machine learning can get to answers also and not just a question?
Yeah, so how should I put this? So malware detection, for example, Let me start with the general principle that I would say. Like, I would say that you can use machine learning very conservatively, and you can use it, and when you use it very conservatively at very, very high certainties. And in my experience, in some cases, that's enough to know that you should, like, say, block a program from executing. At lower certainty, it's useful for like EDR type work, like detecting something suspicious that a human needs to follow up on. So, like, in practice, like, for example, like the phishing detector that we have deployed at my employer, at like super conservative thresholds, we use that to block emails, you know. But then for less conservative thresholds, we use it to like just follow up on an email that looks suspicious, or to put a banner over the email to tell the user, like, be careful, this might be a phishing email, you know. So, I mean, and, you know, signatures also, at least at Sophos, and I think at other vendors and teams also, like, some of the signatures we have out there, we use just for suspicion, you know? I mean, just to, you know, because we found a suspicious observable and we have an analyst follow up on it. And the other ones we use to, like, definitely block this thing from executing right now and quarantine all of its, you know, associated artifacts. So, I don't know, I mostly see, I could keep going. I mean, we could talk after. I think there's a lot of differences, but yeah, it's like, there's a reason that we need both. So yeah, please go ahead.
Sort of a follow-on question to that, actually, yeah. As opposed to signatures. What are your feelings about domain-specific models, you know, like say your IoT or your OTs versus your more generic ones found in the SIM and some of the other, like you said, EDR operations? What are the big key differences you see, and if we're going to be hunting down or finding out from those particular vendors whether or not their models actually work better than something more generic or maybe more domain specific?
Yeah, that's a good question. Okay, I think everybody heard because the gentleman spoke the mic. One thought is that in my experience, when vendors work in a niche, in an area that I feel like feels more niche in our fields, like IoT, when vendors working in a space like that claim to be using machine learning, I'm more suspicious. I approach it more suspiciously. Because machine learning is easiest when in mature fields where we have big data sets of known good and known bads that the machine learning can learn from. So like the classic case, like that most vendors now have a Windows machine learning malware detector. And the reason for that is that we've, as an industry, we've accumulated literally billions of known good and known bad files that you can get off of places like VirusTotal, right? So what people do is they get the data from sources like that and they train these big models, and they work well because of the scale of the data and because we have a fairly mature Windows malware detection in our field. In less mature areas, there's just less training data, it's labeled more poorly, and machine learning is much harder. Not to say you can't use machine learning in a setting like that, but the bar is much higher for, at least for me myself, to become convinced that somebody's using it usefully. They have to be very sophisticated and talking in a really smart way about how they're using it for me to be convinced that it's useful and not just a, you know, marketing bell and whistle. Please.
So you talked about the importance of evaluation.
Yeah.
You also talked about the fact that machine learning is often quite good in a static environment, and you need to go through the process of re-evaluating and relabeling training data in order to keep up with the dynamic environment. Is there a point at which the environment would be too dynamic to actually use machine learning?
Yeah, that's a good question. I think it's hard to answer that in a general way, in the general case. But so I'll say. So in my experience, doing machine learning on I'll answer in a couple ways. So one, classical machine learning assumes that the distribution you're making an inference on is stable, right, and not changing. Now in the real world, things are changing all the time, but machine learning, I think, works less and less well. Like, I think I agree with you. Like, it works less and less well the more the input artifacts are changing. That being said, I think you can do machine learning in an environment that's changing really rapidly. So, for example, I'm trying to think of a good example. This may or may not be a good example, but like we do machine learning on endpoint behavior. That tends to change significantly over time. Like when somebody installs a new software package that we've never seen before, we get really, really different endpoint behavior. In order to deploy machine learning in that environment, we make really aggressive use of heuristics upstream of the machine learning. So basically, by the time like a behavioral trace gets to like our machine learning model, it's already matched heuristics that make it look like really suspicious. And then we apply the machine learning to sort of add some information as to whether or not that's really a suspicious artifact. And that system winds up working usefully, but it's far less accurate. I mean, that's just a harder problem. It's far less accurate than like our Android app detector, which is operating on like, you know, stable, you know, app packages that, you know, aren't changing over time as rapidly. It's not easy to answer in like, you know, in this format. I guess we could talk longer, but those are just some thoughts.
Okay, but in that case, yeah. Are you scared that the heuristic would allow an attacker to find an elaborate threat surface in the machine learning algorithm as you're using the heuristic to relabel and retrain? Are you afraid that a threat actor would misuse that in the end?
Yeah. I mean, that's a problem. That's a problem for sure. Yeah. I mean, you know, these are like some of the, like, yeah, like when you get down to the nuts and bolts about, you know, trying to detect every attack, you immediately confront the problem that you're going to miss stuff. Like, so yeah, I mean, absolutely, people can, you know, get around. Yeah, I mean, no, these aren't foolproof, you know, designs that I'm describing. So please go ahead.
Yeah, I have a very practical problem. I'm looking for a new endpoint solution for my organization. And I know if I go on that vendor floor, everyone is going to say, oh, that's great. We have artificial intelligence you can use with ours.
Yeah.
So is there any kind of tool set or something that I can use when I evaluate these products? I usually do POCs inside my organization. So is there any way that I could evaluate machine learning as kind of a consumer of these things?
Yeah, that's a great question. So no, not really, unfortunately.
Well, thank you for your candor.
Yeah. I think it's a big problem in our fields. You know, it's something I haven't done a huge amount, but I gave a talk at another forum about why we need common benchmarks for security machine learning products and why this is something we need to do just cross vendor in our industry, like establish what we think would be a fair set of benchmarks. And we could talk more about what those might look like, but yeah, I think we need standards for testing how these systems work, and we don't have them. So,
thank you.
Yeah, please go ahead.
Thanks. This was great, by the way.
Thanks.
For those of us who are not as technically astute, that gets down into the mathematics around machine learning and data, what are the three buzzwords that if somebody says them when we're sitting down with them, we should just ought be less polite with the questions and just have them get out of the room? What are the key terms that are obfuscating the understanding of what it is? Digital smoke?
Yeah.
I could throw a few out.
Yeah, I feel like I need to walk the trade floor to get the current the current answer to that question.
All right, I'll see you tomorrow.
But no, you know, I mean, you know, like some of these are so outlandish, I'm not sure people are still claiming them, but, you know, like zero false positives, like, you know, definite no on that one, you know. You know, if people are claiming 100% detection or, you know, they'll detect any malware, or I don't know, you know, that kind of thing.
Okay.
I'm not sure, beyond that, maybe other folks in the audience have answers, but I'm not sure, beyond what I said in the talk, trust the math.
Trust
the math, yeah. Wait, say again? Okay, yeah, because some people are...
Actually, what did he just say? Because I'll write that down when I come back.
No, well, some people are doxing an individual vendor here, which I'm not going to do from the statement. but yeah, we can talk more after. I can't say much beyond what I said in the talk, but it's a good question. Maybe other folks have a contribution.
Thanks, I appreciate it.
For sure, but please go ahead.
Yeah, can you recommend some resources where we could go and see other people that have done research on certain vendors and their machine learning so that, you know, maybe I don't need to spend all the time to do all this research if there's some places that you could point me where I could see what other independent organizations or people like yourself have already done and that could help me evaluate these vendor tools better.
Yeah, that's a good question. I'll say what I do to evaluate how good I think a vendor is. I go to scholar.google.com and I type in the vendor's name. Sometimes I'll type in the names of some of their data scientists from LinkedIn also into scholar.google.com, and I'll see what papers they have. And then I'll read the papers and I'll see how good they are. That's my main signal. To me, it's really important that security data science teams, that they publish their work in peer-reviewed forums in which their peers at other organizations can look at what they're doing. That's important. And if you read the papers, you can see how they evaluated, and you can also see their approaches. And I realize not everybody can do that. Which I mean, this is just a structural problem in our industry that it's hard to know how good they're. But yeah, if you know, for folks who aren't comfortable doing that themselves, asking somebody in your organization to, you know, who maybe can, would, that's the best signal that I know of. So,
okay.
Yeah.
Thanks. That's
sure.
Awesome.
Let's say,
I don't know who is,
evaluating a vendor. Oh, I'm sorry.
Go for it.
Okay, go
let's
ahead.
Let's say I'm evaluating a vendor, and I'd like to see effectiveness of their product.
Yeah.
In real sort of battle.
Mm-hmm.
Right? How do I go about that? I want to do a POC.
Yeah.
I want to stick it in learning mode in my production.
Yeah, yeah.
So it's sucking actual data as it goes. And then I want to see how effective they are, right, practically.
Yeah.
How do I go about that?
So how do you, so the question is how do you evaluate it, like in a POC? I mean, so I think it's important, you know, so don't just use the malicious examples that they give you to test the system.
No, it's
you know,
a
like,
real real flow of the data.
Yeah.
Production. It's not some sample stuff. It's actual real data.
Yeah.
And I usually know what's malicious because I find out afterwards if I missed it.
Yeah, yeah.
Right? So is there something that you can add to what I just said, or is that by itself already?
Yeah, the question, I'm worried that my answer would be too long, right, to get into a discussion about how to do a good POC.
Let's do a summary of the long one.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, I think the obvious things to do, right, are don't, sometimes vendors will give you data that you should evaluate their system on, right? Like give you example malware, for example, that you should use to evaluate. So, you know, that's not super useful since they'll just hardwire their system to detect that stuff. You want to find as representative as possible the kind of threats that you expect the system to detect, and then you want to simulate those threats. And, you know, you want to simulate as close as possible this scenario that you want to protect yourself against, would say, you know. Yeah, I don't know. Best I can do with a short answer. Please go ahead, yeah.
Hi, thank you. I'm a researcher doing research on machine learning, AI, compliance, and audit. And I'll ask the question from a different direction. Everybody wants to know how to evaluate. Is there any emerging standards or any conversation among vendor land at the moment on how to standardize output of their model and software so we can start actually having a much more standard way to ingest the output and maybe do some analysis on it? Because at the moment it's free text, logs, or trying to figure out whether the accuracy is working or not, understanding those operational issues. Is there any emerging standard in the industry or conversation amongst the vendors on how to standardize the output?
How to standardize the predictions that are coming out of the machine learning systems?
No, the actual output of the AI systems. Not interested in the math. It's probably not holy to say that in the machine learning way, but more of the AI systems themselves and how they standardize reporting of what they're doing.
Yeah, I mean, so typically a machine learning system is just embedded in, it's sort of like, you know, think of it like a car, like the machine learning is just like the piston, and then there's a whole bunch of other, you know, there's like the whatever, drive shaft, steering wheel, you know, it's like, oh, I've got one more minute apparently. So typically it's you know, it's in any real security product, it's not like the machine learning is exposed to the user, right? It's buried deep inside the detection logic. And basically, no, there aren't. I'm pretty sure there's no discussions among vendors around how to standardize the ML output. But you know, I think it's a good impulse what you're saying, and I think it goes to the need for much better standards and agreements around how we evaluate these systems. And I think this could be part of it. Yeah. So it looks like maybe we're out of time. But thanks a lot. I really appreciate you guys coming. And feel free to look me up on Twitter or wherever and reach out if you guys want, or come talk to me right after right now. So thanks, everybody.